Good afternoon. Did something happen that I don't know? Why is there only three of you here today? But I think anyway, it might not be a very good day to have a class because today is too hard for me. But I think anyway, we still have to deal with our two readings today. And do you receive the second the file for the second reading? Okay. So very good. And Jess, Do you enjoy your reading this week?
I enjoy.
Would it be too complicated for you?
No, they're not. I'm not a very big fan of
Zhang Dashun. Yeah, right.
But his reading is interesting.
Interesting, right? Okay. And Rachel, do you think this piece of work by Zhang Dashun is very interesting?
I like the idea because it kind of reminds me of those commercials we used to have about kindness and how one act goes around. It reminded me of that, but I'm not sure I was all that interested in the story.
Can you sympathize with the story? Because I mean, are you an urban resident or do you live in the country? In America.
I live in the North Class town.
In New York State.
Yeah.
Okay. And how many people are there in your town? More than 100,000 or less than 100,000?
Less.
Less than 100,000. So we can call it a town, right?
Yeah.
Okay. So how many people were there? Are there in your town?
$5,000 to $10,000.
So okay, so it's a limited amount of a population. Okay, and Miriam, what's your experience of reading these two stories? Do you like it?
They were interesting. Yes, that at times it just felt that they were trying to be too much.
Okay, so I think the tone of the two stories today are quite different from the previous weeks, right? Because most of the tone of the previous stories we have read this semester are quite sad and tragic or stressful, something like that, right? But at least in this week we see two writers. They try to be humorous. They try to be interesting, and they try to be funny, right? So in many aspects of the story. So I think it's very interesting to read these two stories. Okay, so I have entitled this the lecture for today is "Lost in the Big City: Stories by Zhang Dashun and Huang Fan." Of course, they are two very important writers of Taiwan, and also they are two famous promoters of urban literature in Taiwan. So we have to spend this week's lecture on both of them. Okay. Previously, we have dealt with the city in the literature. I mean, that's different. The way the writers before urban literature deal with the city in literature is quite different from Zhang Dashun and Huang Fan. We can see from this. Because in the stories written, for example, written by Huang Chunming, written by Wang Zhenhe, and written by other nativist realist writers, they write people from the countryside and they went into a big city. Right? Do you remember that? Rachel, your taste of apples, especially true, right? Can you refresh our memories about the story?
The family lived in the south, but and decided, my friend and dad decided to move north for a better opportunity. And but the family didn't feel like it was better because the son thought that the teacher was really mean and he didn't find a good job.
Okay. But in a sense, I think the story Taste of the Apples is a quite tragic comic. Because at the same time, we find a very pathetic families. They live in a big city. They could not afford good residence, so live in a shanty house, right? And the only reason why their destiny changed is that the male protagonist, Jiang Afa, was overrun by a car, right? A car driven by an American criminal. Okay, so I think this is very very ironic. Okay, and also we see, I don't think we have read that book, but I have introduced some of the stories in our lectures that there are some powers from the city. They went into the countryside and they try to change the way people live. And the model of life of the countryside. So it also become very tragic. Okay, so let's read. Let's check how many stories are these two types. Okay. Okay. So in the category of the city literature, I mean, they of course cities appear in these works of fiction. Well, there's something for sure. But they are not the main focus. That's not the main focus of this, the story. They just want to focus on the people from the countryside, and they went into the city, and they were treated unfairly. Okay, that's a great problem for them. And we also see the power of the city went into the countryside and changed the life of the people. Okay, for example, in the Taste of Apples, like Rachel has said, this is a story of. The Jiang family, they went from the southern part of Taiwan to Taipei, and they did not could have a good life. But after the father, Jiang Afa, was overrun by an American car, so their life changed. Their life changed from bad to better. Okay. And we also see another story written by Wang Zhenhe, the writer of Oscar for Dowry. This is Xiaolin in Taipei. In this story, we see the main character, Xiaolin. He's a guy from countryside, and he tried to make a living in Taipei. So he went into airline company in Taipei to be an errand boy. He runs errand business for other colleagues. And in this story, we find something very tragic because Xiaolin, the story is told from the perspective of Xiaolin. And Xiaolin found that all his co-workers in this airline company, they were all very snobbish. And they were ass kickers because they were facing the foreigners in the company, they changed the face. And they do not care about those people who are under a lower order of the society. So it is also a very story with a heavy tone of social criticism. And we also see the story, The Drowning of an Old Cat. This story, I have introduced this story, a story by Huang Chunming. The Drowning of an Old Cat, this old cat represents a main character of this story. And this story is describing a village. And these people in this village, they make a living. And their life depend on a well, a very important well for this village. But one day, the rich people, or some of the rich men from the city, they want to build a swimming pool in the village, and so they want to destroy the well. So one of the villagers, he stood up to fight against the people from the city. But of course, at first, many people follow him. But in the end, we see there's less and less people follow him. And he died in despair. And we see he was drowned in the swimming pool. Okay. And the final two story, of course, we have I have labeled these two stories as feminist writings, because first of all, in the first story, we see the love life of a protagonist, the unnamed narrator in this story written by Liang. Last week we have talked about it, and the second story, my son Han Sen, is also narrated from a perspective of mother. The perspective of mother about the troubles his son Han Sen was going through, right? Okay, so Dan, can you tell me about the relationship between city and the love letter never sent? Is it related to the city?
It's more about the love letter never sent. More about the city. It's set in the city.
Mm-hmm.
But it's in terms of people who sometimes do work in the country.
Mm-hmm.
So I guess it's mainly the city with some concern about the
problems. And in the short story, we have talked about three men of the in the love life of the female protagonist, right?
Yeah.
First one is Jiro, and the second one is the husband, and the third one is Xia. And we see Jiro, what kind of person is Jiro? Is he from the city or from the country?
Right where he grew up. I remember where he grew up. He's been in the cities ever since then.
Mm-hmm.
He was educated in the United States.
Yes, he's like me, he's a PhD of comparative literature. But I think one thing we have to remember is that Jiro is from the southern part of Taiwan. He's one of the villagers of the southern part of Taiwan. And one thing very important for him to come back to Taiwan, after he came back to Taiwan, he found that his hometown changed. His original village was changed. So he's always complaining. He was always complaining about that he could not go back to the village, right? So I think this is also very important. A very important issue in the 1970s, because in the 1970s, Taiwan was undergoing a very important transformation, economic transformation, because more and more workers, because I have talked about this in our introductory lecture, more and more human power were needed in order to fill the need of the factories in the city or in the suburban towns, right? So more and more farmers and their sons and daughters, they went into the city and the neighboring suburbs to become factory workers. So the villages, the farming villages became obsolete. So this is a very important social problem. And also, my son Han Sen, can you tell me how this story is related to the city, James? Is this related to the city? The story itself.
I think in many ways it is. One is you kind of have this type of well, first of all, he's a taxi driver.
Yes.
More or less a city.
Yes. Yes.
And then also, second of all, there's this sort of guilt that upper class city dwellers have.
Mm-hmm.
So he
yes.
has some sort of social consciousness,
mm-hmm.
which the upper class of the city doesn't have.
Mm-hmm.
And we also see a kind of ennui of the upper class in the city as well.
Ennui, right. It's a French, right? Okay. I think this is very important, because in this story, we see Han Sen finally became a taxi driver. That is some kind of trade that which is very common in the city. It's not common in the countryside, right? Okay, so my son Han Sen is also describing some of the problems in the city. But we do not know for sure that whether Hansen's father or mother was from the originally the native of the Taipei City. Maybe they are from other parts of Taiwan. And especially something for sure is that Hansen's father, I think he was from mainland China, not from Taiwan, because his mother talked about this. Okay, but in the second category, urban literature, we see a different kind of genre than the city in the literature, because we see the city in the literature, they're dealing with social problems. But in this urban literature, we have two aspects that is quite different. First of all, the writers, for example, Huang Chunming and Wang Zhenhe. Huang Chunming was from Yilan, Taiwan, in the northern part of Taiwan. And Wang Zhenhe was from Hualien, okay? And we see Li Ang, he's from central Taiwan, a small town called Lugang, a traditional town. Of course, the only only exception is Xiao Sa is from Taipei. And from the urban literature, we see two writers. One is Zhang Dazhun. Zhang Dazhun, he's a native of Taipei. He grew up in military compound village in Taipei. And Huang Fan is also a native of Taipei. So the identity of the writer is quite different. And also in this category, we see the protagonists. They are quite different from all these previous stories. For example, in the guided tour of an apartment complex, we see many characters. This is a very challenging job to read this, because we had to read through all these characters. They are all resident in the apartment complex, right? And they are all city resident. Okay. And in the second story, A History of Condo Sales, we also see maybe he's a construction company manager, Zhu Yaozhong. He's also from the city. We see all the social problems in the city was represented in the short story. Okay, so these two respects, I think, is quite different. So we can say that in urban literature, we don't often see the migration model of the story. Okay. So in urban literature, the writers usually talk about the urban world itself. This is quite different. And we have to talk a little bit about the rise of urban literature, the background of this rise. Okay. First of all, we have to mention the rise of urban literature is made possible by economic prosperity since the 1970s. Okay, so we have talked about this all the time, because we know that Taiwan or RC has faced a series of frustrations internationally, right? International setbacks, but economically, Taiwan becomes more and more prosperous. And the second point I have mentioned earlier, because of it was made possible by the writer's urban life experience, especially in their life experience in the apartment. Just, you know that, Miriam, what kind of urban, what kind of house do you live in Norway? Oh yeah, right. Finland, yeah.
At the moment, it's
a single family house. Okay, so it's independent. Okay, and Jess, where do you live in America?
I live in Manhattan, so I live in a very large high-rise building.
Mm-hmm. High-rise building. So it's also an apartment. Apartment, right?
Yeah, but I grew up in the suburbs of Chicago, so that's a typical suburban American house.
Mm-hmm. Okay, I see. So it appears in all the movies in America all the time, right? Okay. And Amanda, where do you live in New York?
I live near the
Yeah, I mean, what kind of restaurant do you live in? Is a condo of a house.
Yeah,
just a house. Okay, then.
Suburban house.
Suburban house. Okay, and Rachel.
Same.
Same. So only James has this kind of experience living in the apartment.
And I live in an apartment here in Taipei
too. Okay.
So it's
on what road? Okay, okay. It's quite a quiet place. Yeah, right. It's a very good place. Is it very quiet?
Usually, yes. But sometimes
usually, yes.
There's a temple which sometimes will start their festivities at 5 a.m.
Mm-hmm.
So, depends.
Okay. So you don't, throughout all your life, most of you do not have this kind of experience living in an apartment, right? Because this is quite different. Because if you live in an apartment or apartment complex, a condo, you have to deal with a lot of people. Your neighbors, maybe sometimes your neighbors are not very desirable or not very good, right? So you have to deal with them. And if you are living in a house, you don't have to deal with those neighbors most of the time. I mean, so I think it's quite different. Okay, so. The reason why those writers, such as Huang Fan and Zhang Dachun, they can write this kind of stories, they write this kind of stories based on their on the basis of their true living experience. So I think this is very important. And the third one is the political freedom, because if you want to criticize, if you have read these two stories, you have a very vivid impression that the writers try to talk about all the social problems, right? And if you criticize about the social problems, you are indirectly criticized about the government. So if it's in a society that is not political free, it will not be allowed to criticize the government. So if you want to write this kind of urban stories, you have to. Some kind, you have to write in an environment that has some extent of a political freedom, right? So I think it's very clear. And in the next point, we see the city in this story is not only a setting, but also a socialized and institutionalized space. This is quite important. And this is quite important to many of the contemporary social theorists. They thought about this a lot. For example, they might be thought about the city as a socialized world. You have to deal with a lot of people in the city, and you have to follow all the rules in the city, right? So it's quite different. So in the city, we have seen all those social problems. For example, chaotic life, class oppression. And urban development, social alienation, right? For example, we can see the problem of social oppression in the first story today, a guided tour of the apartment complex, right? Can you see this problem of social any social problem in the first story, James?
First story. Well, I think the fact that people don't know each other,
mm-hmm.
just not to each other when they pass, but.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Okay. And Miriam, what kind of social problem do you see in the first story, Zhang Dachun's story? Yes. Yes. Okay, very good. Dan, do you see any social problems? So you prefer to tell me that it's their own problem, not social problem, right?
More so, yeah, I think so.
Okay.
Because I don't have a different problem.
Okay. Okay. And Rachel?
Yes. More that they just pass by each other.
Mm-hmm.
Almost like they don't exist, like they don't have their own world.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Okay. And Mina? Thank you. Okay. If we want to know about the urban literature of Taiwan, we have to talk about this this book. It's a novel written by Xin Yong. We have talked about him a lot of times during this whole semester. And this is a novel called Crystal Boys. It was published in 1983. I think it's earlier than both of the two stories today. And if you had a chance to check this book, this novel, English, of course, it has an English translation, and you can find on the cover it was publicized as the first Asian gay novel. So it's about a group of gay in Taipei, a group of gay men in Taipei. And first they located themselves in the east, western part of Taipei, and later on they were driven eastward by the police. Okay, so they finally settled down in a gay bar in the east district. But after police shakedown, the gay bar has to be closed. So they went back to the west district of Taipei. Okay, so this is quite simple story. But in this story, we see many problems. Though. For example, the father-son problem. Maybe this is about this is a reflection of Bai Xinyong himself, because he never had a chance to talk with his father about this kind of gay problem, the problem of gay relationship. Okay. And in this short story, of course, in this novel, Taipei was represented through a dichotomous structure. Dichotomous structure, it means that we can see the eastern part of Taipei and the western part of Taipei. And the dividing line between the eastern part and the western part of Taipei, do you know the dividing line of these two words? Do you know this? Yes, you have to live in Taipei for many years, right?
Zhongshan.
Yes, right. Zhongshan North Road and Zhongshan South Road. If you cross the Zhongshan North Road eastward, it's in the eastern part of Taipei. And if you cross the Zhongshan North Road westward, you are in the western part of Taipei. Okay, so it's quite simple to know that. And in this short story, we see the two different parts of Taipei. One is West District, and the second one is the East District. And West District is presented as old Taipei, and the East District is presented as new Taipei. And if you want to ask me where are we right now? Where are we now right now? Are we in the eastern part or western part of Taipei? Yeah, we are in the southern part of Taipei. Okay, and also in this short story, in this novel, we see the west district is represented as a place for the poor people to live, and the east district as the world of the rich people. Okay, and also in this west district, we see a lot of local culture of Taipei. And in the East District, we can see a lot of international powers that is going to Taipei. For example, we can see a Japanese pharmaceutical company in the Songjiang Road in this short story and in this novel. Okay. And can you name another city like this? It was divided into two parts. Can you name this kind of city?
Berlin.
Yeah, but it's due to political reason, right? Okay, and some other cities, yeah. Is it the case in New York?
Yeah.
I'm not sure about New York. It might be in St. Louis. There's St. Louis, Missouri, and there's the east side of St. Louis, which is the Illinois side.
Mm-hmm.
And the difference there is.
And what's the difference between these two sides?
There's a river, pretty big river.
Can you describe the difference?
East St. Louis is really, really poor and really dangerous. And St. Louis, Missouri, like the rest of St. Louis, I mean, there's probably bad parts, but it's not that bad.
Mm-hmm. And does it have a very clear distinction line between these two parts?
Yeah, there's a river. I mean, they're in two different states. It's the same. I mean, it's kind of the same city, but they're in two different states.
Oh.
Two different governments, and they're separated by this really big river.
Mm-hmm. Okay. So if you cross the bridge, you are going to another world.
Yeah.
Okay. And Rachel, can you name another city like this? Have you ever been to New York, New York City?
I go to
college in New York City. A college in New York City. Okay. What's your experience in New York City?
But I guess it's like uptown where it's classier.
Mm-hmm.
Maybe
mm-hmm.
places like Harlem where it's darker.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Very good. So it's we can always find this kind of distinction between. Two parts of in the same city. Of course, I think you might be forgetful of some place there, which is very famous. What is the place for Olympic Games this summer? London, right? So okay, what do London have? No, they have a terminology, special terminology. What is the? It's also East and West, but it's a. It's East End and the West End. Do you remember that? Oh, right. East End of course. London has its northern part and the southern part. The southern part of the Thames River, right? Across the South Thames River, you are in the southern part of London. But historically, we see this kind of distinction between East End and West End. We see West End as the place for rich people, and as the place for the aristocratic class. Right, and we see West End as the culturally higher classes. For example, this is the place where Oscar Wilde and those people that kind of people live. Right, and in the East End we see all kinds of people from the British colonies. For example, they were from Malaysia, they were from Hong Kong, they were from. They were from India, some places like that, and East End is usually treated as some kind of very mysterious and very sinful place. For example, you know the case, very important historic case of Jack the Ripper, right? Jack the Ripper, the historic case happened in the East End. So one of the main reasons that the London city government want to hold the Olympic Games is that they try to revitalize East End, and so they build many stadiums and many places for Olympic Games in the East End, and they try to procure for the local residents more jobs with this kind of Olympic Games. So this is also a very important distinction between the East End and the West End of London. Okay. And also the last point of this novel is Crystal Boy is Bai Xianyong. We know that Bai Xianyong among all the Taiwanese writers, he's one of the few Taiwanese writers that has a very precise perspective of international society. Because he can travel to America at a very early age. So he knows a lot of things about America, and then he went to New York and Chicago and LA. So he writes stories about those places, and he also teach. He also first he's retired right now, but once he was a professor of Chinese literature and language in UC Santa Barbara. So he write about a lot of stories about the cities in the United States. And also he tried to compare Japan with Taipei because we know that Taiwan and Japanese has a very close relation in the colonial history, right? So he also tried to compare these two cities. Okay. First of all, we can talk a little bit about Zhang Dazhuan, the writer himself, and Huang Fan, the writer. Of course, here I have mentioned five stories by Zhang Dazhuan and Huang Fan. The first one is the story Speaker of the Asai. Speaker of the Asai is a quite interesting story because this is a story about a couple. And the female protagonist is he's a writer, and the male protagonist is he's a man with a very good memory, and so in many ways he can help the female writer, and but that is not a point. From this story we can see that many of the protagonists in Zhang Dazhuan's short stories are they have some kind of a job that can only have only the residents of the city can have, okay? And the second one is LE116 Liaoning Street. Liaoning Street is in the eastern part of Taipei. And this is where Zhang Dazhuan grew up. He was he's a resident of the military compound village. And he tried to use his personal background to write this short story. So this we can see how special military compound village are in the city. And the third one is also a story about a mainland veteran who live in Taipei City, and we can see this short story. This is mainly about the political problems and social problems. The lives of these veterans, okay. And Huang Fan, he also wrote about the city life a lot. For example, he wrote A Man of Scruples, Fan Mingshu or Shu Mingfan, because the protagonist's name is Fan Mingshu, the just and the fair. But it's quite ironic. So we in this short story, through the process of the narrative, we did not see this Fan Mingshu as a very just and a very fair person. Because in the end, we see, because he's a general manager of a department store, but he did not manage the company in a very fair and just way. And he did not treat his workers very well. And in the end of the story, we see the department store, the security staff of the department store, they called a little girl who was charged with the crime that she damaged all the properties of the department store. And Fan Mingshu decided to give the girl to the police. I think this is not a very fair thing to do, because she's only an 11 or 12 year old girl. And in the rainy night, this is also about some story in the city. Of course, all these story, short stories you can find in English version. So if you are interested in these two writers, you can read these short stories. Okay. First of all, we can run through a little biographical details of Zhang Dazhuan. He was born in 1957 in Taipei City, and he attend both BA and MA degrees from Fulham Catholic University. So he's sort of my senior. And from the department in the Graduate Institute of Chinese Literature. So he's a very famous, he's used a very famous lecturer of Chinese literature. And he's one of the most prolific Taiwan writers since the 1980s. And he used to be an instructor of Chinese literature in Fulham University, and he was a host of TV programs, and now a host in the FM radio talk show, FM 98.1. So if you turn on the radio every day from Monday to Friday, and from 3 p.m. to 5 p.m. and to FM 98.1, you can listen to the program of Zhang Dachun. He's a very talkative guy. Of course, if you want to be a host of a radio show, you have to be a very talkative guy. And he is a very great talker, I think. And during his whole literary career, we can see Zhang Dachun has shown some kind of versatility, because he can write all kinds of short stories. First of all, we can see he writes about science fiction. This is one story called named Bing Bian in English, plague. It's about a plague, yeah, science fiction about plague. And he also wrote about historical and political novels, for example, Lucky Words About His Country, and Sa Huang Ge Xin Tu, the Christian Who Lied. And this is about our former president, Li Denghui, okay? And we also talk about his, in our introductory lecture, we also talk about his The General's Monument. This is a work of magic realism. And he's also one of the pioneers of postmodern metafiction in Taiwan. If Lin Xiuxiu hadn't. This is a very interesting story, because the writer trying to explore the possibility of a story. So you, if you have a chance, you can read this. This is also very, very interesting, maybe as interesting as the story for today. And he also writes about post 1949 writing for the life of the veteran members. For example, in Birds of a Feather, Ji Ling Tu, he writes about a mainland veteran. He doesn't have many families in Taiwan, so he tried to keep a group of chickens, and he named those chickens from his own family's names. Okay, so this is a very tragic story, because by the end of the story, we see the veteran kill all those chickens by himself. Okay, so maybe let's take a break first and continue later. Okay.
Hello, everyone. I'm going to report about Zhang Dachun's short story. This is Zhang Dachun, and first I'll give a little bit of a background about him. I'm not going to talk too much about his background and his politics, but I'm going to mention a few things because later on you can see it inside the short story. He's actually quite young, probably one of the youngest writers we've read so far, and he's originally, even though he's born in Taiwan, he's originally, his family's originally from Shandong. He started writing in the 70s and 80s, and he became quite successful. In 1998, he became a chief writer for China Times Literary Supplement. And the literary supplements here in Taiwan have a very special position. They're quite important in Taiwanese literature here. In 1998, he became a radio show host, and he's also quite popular in the mainland. And some of his comments are quite controversial, such as Taiwan's cultural industries are shit, and his previous criticisms of the Chen Shui-bian administration, saying that basically Chen Shui-bian's positions are may lead to some serious trouble, and his insisting that the administration rethink their policies. Okay, so let's talk a little bit more about the story. So even though he's born in Taiwan, his stories are very different from the other stories that we read. The 70s was a time of very strong nativist writing in Taiwan. Oxford for Dalry's nativist literature, Country Village Teacher isn't, but Country Village Teacher still has a very strong Taiwanese flavor to it. So even though the story is set in Taipei, written by a writer who's born in Taiwan, it has a very different flavor from these other two, which depict Taiwanese society. This depicts, I would say, more of a Taipei society than a Taiwanese society. And you can see his mainland background in his choice of characters. And I'll talk a lot more about the characters a little later on in detail. But you see how common soldiers are in his writing. You have an authority figure of a general, then you also have a lieutenant colonel. And also you see this type of, I would say, anti-foreign sentiment in his writing, which is quite common in the writing of mainlanders, even in Taiwan. For example, a few stories back, we read a story saying, I couldn't believe that you would work for the Japanese. Well, that's, of course, a mainland writer in Taiwan. You don't see this sort of you don't see that much anti-foreigner sentiment written by native Taiwanese writers, especially towards the Japanese. But here you have a bit of anti-foreign sentiment in his depiction of the Chinese girl who was with the American lawyer. The girl is ethnic Chinese, so he's contrasting her from possibly being ethnic Taiwanese. So let's continue. The story is very, very interesting. I want to talk a lot about the techniques that the writer is using. Because right from the beginning, he's able to establish the mood very, very well. You can tell it's going to be there's going to be a lot of comedy in this right from the beginning. For example, the name in Chinese, Fu Li, and then Fully, then Foolish, and then also his wife felt slighted, and this completely destroyed their relationship over this totally insignificant thing. You know there's going to be a lot more of this type of entertainment coming up. And then also, right at the beginning, he's talking about the custodian, the military, former instructor at the military academy, Mr. Kwan. And you see right here his use of chasing away thieves. This actually sets the mood because these thieves aren't real thieves. These are just high school kids who want to get some supplies for the project. If he really didn't want to have such a lighthearted tone to the story, he could have chased away real thieves.
James, use your microphone. Oh,
so if he didn't want to have such a lighthearted theme, lighthearted mood in the story, they could have been real thieves, but these are just high school kids who want equipment. So right from the beginning, also he's talking about urine so much. So you have a very, very, very successful, I would say, usage of creating a very lighthearted mood in the story right from the beginning. And then also he introduces the characters somewhat indirectly sometimes. For example, you know that Mr. Guan originally is from Sichuan because he's saying that he has a smell for eating too many peppers and peppercorns. So peppercorns are huajiao, it's Sichuan food. And also, when he could have directly said that Mr. Guan's originally from Sichuan, but it would have conveyed a much different mood than saying that this man actually smells like peppercorns. So I think that's a very good usage, a very lighthearted usage there. So the mood is set right in the beginning. And then, let's see. I thought here, when he was describing the lecture, Mr. Lean living in 11E, I think this is actually quite humorous. This boy, he told everyone he slept with a girl, and the girl told everyone also lies, saying that this boy was annoying her with letters. And then later, they lived in the same place. So here's a Taiwanese expression here, saying you shouldn't be going around saying these type of stories about people because you never know when you'll run into them again. But when I was reading this about Mr. Lean, I thought that this is possibly Zhang Dachun creating a character in a story which he relates to himself. A lot of times authors like to create characters in the story which either are based on them or that they respect or they aspire to become. So here you have somebody who's smart, happily married, successful, smart children, girlfriends on the side, of course. He enjoys reading late into the night. So when I read these type of stories, and I always see it, but if I I see a character inside a story which likes to read or possibly writes, I always think, okay, this is possibly the writer trying to put himself into the story. So let me continue. Okay, the retired general cursed himself for a prostate operation, which is quite funny. And then he liked an older woman. Some of this woman lived in the mansion. The general told her the story about the drunken love. And the drunken love, of course, is her son. But this part here, her comment to him, if you translate this back into Chinese, this is actually probably one of the most funny parts of the whole story. Because she said, you're right, people today are not brought up properly. But in Chinese, saying somebody's not brought up properly means yao jiao. This is not an insult to them. This is an insult to their parents. So she's actually insulting herself. So in Chinese, this story is even funnier than it is in English translation.
Yes, so you read both the Chinese version and the English version?
Not for this story, but when I saw this, people are not brought up properly. In my head, I just translated that back to Chinese. Life in the city versus the country. Taiwanese natives literature normally focuses on the countryside, but here you have literature focusing on the city. People not in agreement for each other. This is typical of city literature anywhere in the world. And I think a very interesting theme in the story is coincidence and interconnectedness. You have Yi Wangchun went to 12B on accident, and the woman thought there was a gunman at the door. A whole chain of events occurred. But I think actually in this story, interconnectedness is mostly a writer's technique. What I think he's doing is he has a lot of independent short stories in here, which are very, very funny. All of them are quite comic in themselves, but he has to somehow try to tie them together. He can't just give us all these stories right in a row, because we won't really believe it. Or maybe we'll think it's just a series of jokes. So what he does is he strings them together with people running into each other, then running into somebody else, then running into somebody else. And later on, you see the same technique used by him when he has the children. He wants to bring up a lot more stories. So what he actually does is he has the children go out in the hallway and listen and smell and so on, but not see. And this allows him, when they're walking through everybody next to everybody's apartment, to be able to bring out all these little individual stories he normally would not be able to. So I think when I look at this story, of course coincidence and interconnectedness are very important, but I think mostly what he's doing here is creating one story out of many smaller stories. And then
James, can we stop here? Go back to the last slide. you mentioned coincidence here, because we know that coincidence is a very important literary element in all of the short stories and novels, right? But we can see sometimes coincidences are persuasive, and sometimes coincidences are not persuasive. And how do you think of the coincidences in this short story?
I think some of them are persuasive, mm-hmm. Some of them are not. Some of them are too far-fetched.
What some of them are not persuasive?
I think the lottery ticket is not persuasive.
Okay. You mean the architect's wife jumped on the lottery winner? The last scene of the story?
I think the man just winning the lottery.
You mean the lottery ticket was hidden in the cigarette box? And it was thrown to the man.
Yeah.
Okay.
That wasn't persuasive.
Okay.
For me, here also it's very interesting, and I like this technique here because he's talking about Madame Bovary. Now, Madame Bovary is a very famous book, but it's actually a tale of adultery.
Yeah.
And the woman in the story, she's married to a doctor.
Architect.
An architect.
Yeah.
She's married to an architect, and then she goes.
You mean in this story?
In this story.
This story is architect, and in Madame Bovary's story is doctor. Yes.
So she has the writer portrays her as having opened the book of Madame Bovary on her bed. So it's a tale of adultery. She goes to this nightclub, and she almost has an adulterous affair with somebody. She's going there in search of one, but his usage of the book is he clarifies it a little bit by saying not since college, because if he didn't clarify it, we don't know whether she wanted to have an adulterous affair, so she picked up the book. But here, she already had the book. So possibly the book is what influenced her to have this adulterous affair. So she was reading a book that she already had since college, and then she decided to go to the nightclub and take a look. And then she changed her mind and came back. But the funniest line in the whole book, besides the Tiao incident, was when she hit the dog on the way back. Because the exact words that he used were, his one and only true friend, the owner of the dog, his one and only true friend has disappeared for seven days in search of a mate. But actually, the dog was run over by somebody who was also in search of a mate.
So men are compared to dogs, right?
Well, the woman was in search of the mate, so I think the woman is very similar to the dog in this case.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, well, thank you, everyone.
James, enjoy reading this story very much. And how about you, Rachel? Do you enjoy this story? In the process of reading, does it make you laugh?
Some
part of it.
A bit overwhelming with all the people, stuff like that.
Mm-hmm.
But it was amazing.
Mm-hmm. Okay. So, I think if you are reading this kind of a story with many characters, I suggest that you, if you had time, you can read it several times. And sometimes you can find a relationship among these characters. It's very interesting. Dan, how about you?
I had problems keeping track of the characters too. I could see where some of them come along, but it's hard for me to remember the names.
Mm-hmm.
But I liked it. It was a little bit almost ridiculous the way the characters came together and interacted with each other so much. But it was an entertaining story.
Mm-hmm. Okay, very good. And Miriam, what's your perspective on this story? And is this kind of apartment complex very common in Finland?
There has been not that long,
just about from
the 70s.
Late 70s, okay.
This kind of story is common.
Okay. And Amanda, what's your impression about this story? It was okay.
I like they pointed out. I do think it was a little overwhelming.
Too many characters, right?
Yes.
Okay.
That was one of the things that I liked. I mean, I could see where it was humorous, but I don't know if it really made me really funny.
Mm-hmm.
It was just like, oh.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Very good. I think this is a good question for us to ask. Why did Zhang Dao use so many characters? Maybe that's just the point that he wanted to express in this short story. The characters. So, like James has talked about this, because maybe he wanted to give us all these characters and to remind us that somehow those characters were related to each other in a very coincidental way or very complicated way, right? So I think this is very, very important. So this piece of work was published in 1986 in UNIDAS. This is a very important literary journal in Taiwan, Lianhe Wenxue. And I think the story structure, when we are talking about this, the story structure of this short story, you can take a look at, or you should pay attention to all these characters and see the relationships among all these characters, and maybe you can find the story structure, and maybe you can use my way later on. I will explore it more, so because you can use the structure of the building as the story structure. So we can see that this is a short story with a gathering place that is a fully or foolish building. We have many characters, and those characters have each of these characters have its own, their own episodes. Okay. And the ending of the story, James, what's the ending of the story? The end of the story.
Thanks us for being part of this tour.
Mm-hmm. No, I mean, the last the paragraph of the story.
I think the woman died, and then the children are changed.
Yeah, yeah. But okay, let's go, anyway, we in the end of the story we see the architect's wife. Maybe she's going to be crushed by the last room was going to be crushed by the architect's wife, right? Okay, so that's the end of the story. So this story is both tragic and comic, right? And the theme of this story. What do you think the theme is? Of course, we see many themes in the story, right? And can you name one of the themes in this story?
One of the themes I would say is you don't really know the people who you're living right next to.
Mm-hmm.
Anyway.
Very good. Okay. And Miriam, what do you think the theme of the story is? Okay, Dan.
The role of chance and random occurrences in life.
Mm-hmm. Okay, Rachel. We have talked about what is theme, right? The message that the writer wants to express in the short story. Okay, what do you think Zhang Daozhen wants to express in the short story? And we can see several couples in this short story, right? And what's Zhang Daozhen's perspective on a marriage or a relationship between men and women?
It doesn't seem to end well.
Okay. And do you agree with him?
I think it depends on the couple.
Uh-huh.
And the people.
Mm-hmm.
It doesn't always not end well.
Mm-hmm. Okay, Dan, do you agree with Zhang Daozhen's perspective on relationship and marriage?
I don't know. I think it's just too
complicated. Okay, maybe one day when you get married, you can thought about this. You can thought back to this short story. Okay, so I think we can explore many things in this short story, and they are all very interesting. Okay. But I think for myself, this is very interesting. A very interesting in this short story is it's about the social, a special connectedness of our city life and the social disconnectedness of city life. This is very important because all the residents in the complex were unknowingly closely related to each other, but they were closely related. Not only they live in the same place. That is named as the Fortune Building, but also they were related to each other in their life, right? So I think this is very important. And this story is both the micro and the macro perspective of the society. Okay, through this story we can understand how urban novels and stories are written on the basis of the structure of the city. Okay, and also many jobs of residents make this building an epitome of the society. This is very important. Like my son Hans Hansen, we have seen many jobs of in Hansen's life, right? And in this building we know as a apartment complex, we also see the residents have many jobs. Okay. Okay. This is a Fortune Building. We know this is an apartment complex. It has this is a complex that is composed of four buildings, A, B, C, D, four buildings, right? And each building has 12 floors. Okay, and from this picture, we can see the structure of this short story is very clear. If you draw this picture by yourself, and you can like Rachel, then you, and Amanda, your opinion on this story. You think the characters and the relationship are too complicated. But if you want to have a clear picture of their relationship, maybe you can draw a picture like this. For example, we can talk about this a little bit. For example, from the building A, right? The apartment building A. From the 12th floor, we have Fan Yanfan, the architect, and her wife. Right. So later on, her wife, John, found the top of the building, and maybe she's going to die, right? And we also see the relationship between the residents of this apartment complex. For example, we see this. We see this in this part of the building. We have Wei Danzhen. James, do you remember who is Wei Danzhen? You know, we don't know what did he do, but we have a story about him and his wife, right?
Is it the wife who heard about the Tarzan situation?
Yes, right. And what kind of character is Wei Danzhen? Is his main quality?
He's a very jealous man.
Uh-huh.
And then he came back and it said they went to war for 2 hours or something.
Yes. So they have very serious fight, right?
Well, see. Yeah.
Yeah. They have very serious fight, and then what happened? Does this fight affect other residents?
Yeah, because he knocked over a chair and then he knocked over our vase, and when the vase fell down, it broke, and the neighbors next door thought they were scared by it, and then it ruined.
And who are the neighbors next door?
They're a happy couple thinking about getting married.
Do you think they are happy?
Well, they weren't. But
yeah, let's the couple named Huang Xiaoling and Zhu Guodong, right? And after the fight, something happened to this couple.
Yeah, she didn't want anything to do with him, and then she hit him.
Mm-hmm.
Because she thought he doesn't want to marry her.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so this is very important, because this is the way Zhang Dazhun used to describe the relationship among all these residents of this apartment complex. And this is the way Zhang Dazhun used to tell us that even if you don't know you are related to each other in a big city, but somehow you are related to each other, right? So I think this is very important. And also we have a very important, this is maybe from 10C, Zhang Dechong. Do you remember who is this guy, Zhang Dechong? He's insurance company assistant manager.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
Right.
He was cheating with the company he works for.
Yes. And what does his Chinese name mean? Zhang Dechong. His Chinese name is Zhang Dechong. Okay. This is a Chinese lesson. Okay, De means what does De mean in Chinese? Morality, right? And Chong, what does Chong mean? Fullness. So from his name, we know that Zhang Dechong, this character, should be full of morality, right? But actually, it's quite the contrary, because we know he's an immoral person. He's an immoral manager of a social insurance company, right? So this is also very very interesting, okay? And also we see this this in 8A, in 8B we see this Yi Wanjun. What does Yi Wanjun do? We don't know his we don't know her formal job, but we know her part-time job. Yes, right. We have a part-time prostitute. And you say that her behavior after her drunkenness affected the life of Mrs. Qi, in the top of the 12B, right? Yeah, right. But because she went to the top floor and she used her key to open another woman's door, and Mrs. Xu thought it was a gunman at her door, right? So she died from a heart attack, right? Okay, so this is a bit funny from the perspective of reading. And maybe you can check this out for yourself. You can use this to refresh your memories about this all these characters and their behavior and their mutual inference. Okay, and we have so many characters in this story, so we can take a look at this. The first one is Guan Youkai. He's a custodian, and he used to be a lieutenant colonel in the army, right? And this is like James has talked about. This is one social concern that usually appears in Zhang Dazhun's writings because these veterans they are all mainlanders, and after they retire, they could not find a very good job in the society. So many of them find a job as a custodian or some kind of a gardener or something else. And so this we can see that this guy named Guan Youkai, he always compares his present life and his past life. We know that his past life is very good because in army he used to be a high ranking officer, and in this apartment complex we see him as a lower end of the society. And the second in 12A we see the architect and his wife Ni Nanshi. Okay, and we see that this couple could not get along very well. And we also see Ke Kaidi and Tao Dao. They are TV producer and TV program host. And we also see Gui Danson, but we did not know his job. Okay. And in 6A, we see James Janice and his girlfriend, Susan. And does this girlfriend has a Chinese name?
No, I don't think so.
So I think this is also very interesting. Because she's a Chinese, but she doesn't have a Chinese in this short story, right? So, and this girlfriend is James Janice. He's James, but he's a lawyer. You're not a lawyer. This is a new girlfriend that James met the other night earlier in the park, right? Okay, and we also see in 12B the Mrs. Chi, the victim of a heart attack. And also we see Yi Wan Jun, she's a part-time nightclub hostess or prostitute, okay. And we also see Liang Runlong, he's a retired general, okay. And we also see Tenzi, he's an assistant manager of an insurance company, but actually he's not a good. And what happened to Zhang Dezong in the end of the story?
He went to America.
Yeah, he went to America and he tried to live a new life in America. And we also see Liu Zhiren, he's a tea merchant, but I don't think he has a very impressive episode. And we also see a young couple, Huang Xiaoling and Zhu Guodong. And we also see the unlucky lottery winner. This is a effect of a tragic comedy, right? Actually, he's very lucky, but in the end of the story, we don't see he's very lucky, right? He's going to be crushed by the wife of the architect, okay? So this is something very ironic. And we also see the Guan Difan, he's a painter. James, what do you think of Zhang Dazhun's perspective on the painter?
I think he just brought the painter in only for that one joke, where mm-hmm. it's about the sweat gland, which is making his apartment smell.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Very good. And also, we see this guy Lin Binghong. He's a manager of a trading company. And what's the problem with Lin Binghong?
Well, the girl thinks he's a pervert, and he was lying to people earlier.
No, I mean his own problem. he can't sleep, right? He can't sleep all the time. So he wandered around the street in midnight. And we also see, invite Wu Baoming and his kids, these two kids, they are also very interesting, the twins. Okay, so the implication of the name of the building, I think this is very important, and Jess has talked about it. Because we know that Lin Nanshi suggests that the English name of the building can be translated as fully building, right? But his husband refused this suggestion. Why? Because he thought that this is something like foolish, so he cannot accept that. So fully mentioned, or it was translated as fully mentioned or fortune building in Chinese. Okay, and in the beginning of the short story, we are told that the architect Fan Yangfan was not satisfied with the English translation. Okay, but because there is not any corresponding word in English which can express the Chinese phrase "fuli," wealth and stability. I think "fuli" is a phrase from Confucius' writing. Because in Chinese we say "fu er hao li." What does it mean by "fu er hao li"? "Fu er hao li," it means that if you are both wealthy and civilized, then you are a morally good person. So I think this is according to the moral code of Confucius. This is very important. But in this building, we did not see that kind of person, right? I think so. This is very ironic, because in the building the name of building is wealthy and civilized. We have all those buildings, all those residents that they are wealthy, but they are not civilized. They are rude to each other. For example, the custodian, he's a retired lieutenant general of high school, and he used to pee in the elevator and drinking, right? So he's not a very polite person. Every time he was cleaning the elevator mat, he always thought about the single lady Yi Wanjun, because she has nice breasts and well padded bottom. So this is very interesting. So he's not a very polite or very moral person. And Yi Wanjun, she's also a morally defective woman, because we know that Yi Wanjun was a woman with secrets. She moonlighted 3 nights a week in the Sister King's place, which might be some kind of a high class brothel or nightclub. Okay, so she's not a morally perfect woman. And we also see Lin Binghong. He's a trading company manager and an insomniac. Though hardworking and educated, he cheated regularly on his wife, right? He had two girlfriends, and he can enjoy her time every Tuesday or Friday, right? Okay. And neither was Zhang De Chong, the resident of the 10C and an assistant manager of an insurance company, a decent person, because he had been having private deals with the auto repair shops in order to jack up prices. So it's also ironic, because we know that his name is very moral, but his person is not very moral. Okay. So in this short story, we see the building is seen as some kind of symbol of social alienation. All of these problems, social problems, are social alienation. For example, Lin Nanshi, the architect's wife, thought that the building was an instrument of alienation, because her husband rejected that her proposal, right? And her impression of the building might express a major idea that Zhang Dazhen wanted to convey through this story. The residents there were not civilized. What is worse, we can see among the many cases of alienation of a highly prosperous modern society, especially in the city life. Among all these residents, we can categorize them. For example, we can characterized as the low-school tree. There are many people cheat on their wives. For example, Major Lin cheated on his wife, and General Lin would have done that with his folk dance partner, a middle-aged widow, and he had his prostate operation already, okay, right? And we also see those people who don't get married, Huang Xiaoling and Zhu Guodong, the couple in 7C, were not having a stable relationship, because judging from Zhu's concept of marriage, Huang thought Zhu would not marry her. After they fell out, Zhu would go to a dance hall in order to have a good time with other women. And in the dance hall, he ran into Lin Nanshi, right? And Lin Nanshi tried to find a match in the dance hall. And we also see those who suspect he's a very suspicious man, Wei Dancheng. Also, we see Wei Dancheng, a man thought his wife had been cheating on him. He lived in 7A, okay? And we also see those who die in this short story. But of course, they die for some ridiculous reason. Maybe we can say that Mrs. Chi, her death was an accident, right? And we can say that the last winner is even more tragic, because he's not supposed to die after he won the lottery, right? And I think the most ridiculous death is Lin Nanshi, because it's simply because of his rejection, her rejection of her husband, right? So I think this is the most ridiculous of all. Okay, so toward the end of the story, we are about to witness the double tragedy. Okay, after Lin Nanshi jumped down from the top of the building, she was about to crash on Lai Jincai, ironically a recent lottery winner of $3 million. Okay, and so in this short story, we can see, maybe we can see Zhao Dazhen's perspective of marriage in this city. Okay, and why did the architect's wife commit suicide? Yes. Why did Lin Nanshi commit suicide?
She was protected by her husband and she felt guilty.
Yeah, and I think she encountered a series of frustrations in marriage, and this is the reason why she committed suicide, right? And for example, after she went back from the dance floor to her home, her husband was not there, right? And after 2 days, her husband returned. So I think the two did not get along very well. So I think this is not just the rejection problem, also other problems. Okay. So we see all these couples, Fan Yangfan, Lin Nanshi, Wei Dancheng, and Mrs. Wei, and Huang Xiaoling and Zhu Guodong. They are not very. And also we can see the general and her wife, they all have some kind of problem, okay? So we can see Zhu Guodong. I think this passage can express Zhang Dazhen's perspective on marriage, and he used Zhu Guodong as his mouthpiece to express this idea. Okay, so after Zhu Guodong heard the fight between Wei Dancheng and Mrs. Wei, he said that that's the way it goes after marriage. A skirmish every couple of days, a battle every 5 or 6 days. So this is, I think this is very important, because sometimes this is quite common in the experience of marriage, because you are all unmarried, right? So you don't have this kind of experience, but maybe you have girlfriend and a boyfriend, and you have a serious fight with them, but after the fight, you reflect on yourself, and then you found that the reason for the fight is very ridiculous, and I don't know whether you have this kind of experience. Then do you have this kind of experience? No.
Not so much.
Amira, do you have this kind of experience? You have a fight, but after your reflection, you found that it's very ridiculous. The fighting is all very good. It's very important. The fighting itself is very, very ridiculous. Okay? So this is maybe this is the Finnish perspective on marriage, right? Okay. Okay. So that's about this short story by Zhang Dachun. Okay. And James, do you have other things to say about Zhang Dachun and this short story?
Mm-hmm. Is that a mainland name?
Not so much a mainland name. It is quite common in both Taiwan and the mainlanders. Taiwanese and mainlanders. Yeah. Okay. So I think both Zhang Dachun and Huang Fan, they use this kind of wordplay very much. So sometimes translated texts are not able to express their ideas fully. Express their idea. So if you had the chance to learn Chinese, then you can read these stories more fully, fully understand these stories. So maybe you can find a Chinese text to read. Okay. So this is a main idea of Zhang Dachun's short story. Okay. And okay. Maybe we have some time left, so I can go into some details about Huang Fan's biographical background. Okay. Have we read about Huang Fan this semester? No, not yet. Okay. So this is the story. This is the first story about Huang Fan this semester, and Huang Fan used to be a very important Chinese writer. So we have to deal with some of his biographical details. He was born in 1950 in Taipei, and he's a graduate of the Zhongyuan College of Science and Engineering. This is a very famous famous college in Zhongli, Taoyuan. And in 1979, with Lai Shuo, his first piece of fiction, he won the United Daily News Fiction Competition. This is very important because all this younger generation Taiwanese writers, They are very winners. They are all the winners of the literary awards. So this in the earlier part of in the past, it used to be a very important way to be famous in the literary scene. So I think this is very important. And this story, Lai Shuo, is a short story. Is a thing of politics set in the 1970s, and a period which was both confusing and exciting for many Taiwanese. We know that 1970s we had many activities of the political oppression and the political protest against the KMT government. And in this short story, Lai Shuo, he's a marginal and a naive figure in Taiwan's independence movement. Do you know about the independence movement? Yes. Do you know about the independence movement? Because in we can go to that next class. Let's talk about the independence movement. We know that independence movement. There's a group of people in Taiwan. They are usually Taiwanese, and they claim that Taiwan is not a part of China. This is a very controversial political proposition in Taiwan. So this group of people, they were arrested or persecuted due to the martial law and due to the political control of KMT government. And in this short story, Lai Shuo is a part of this independence movement. They claim the independence of Taiwan from mainland China, but he's only a guy who was hired by the leader of the independence movement to dispatch the posters, and he was arrested and he was jailed for many years, and later on when he went back from the jail, he found that Taiwan has become different, and the political position of the of the leader of the independence movement has also become different. So I think this is a very representative, one of the earliest representative story written by Huang Fan to present the transformation of Taiwan and the world city. Okay, so this is Lai Shuo. Okay, and there's also a very important piece of work written by Huang Fan, and everybody needs Qin De Fu. From this title of this short story, we know that this story is very ironic, because we know that after reading the story, we know that not everybody needs Qin De Fu. It's everybody needs Qin De Fu's money. He's needed by everybody else for his money, because he's very rich. He's a criminal. He controls the underground economy of Taipei. He's very rich. He's a rich guy, but he has very few friends. Maybe his only friend is his childhood playmate and the narrator of this short story. Okay. And we say that some of the critics say that this everybody needs Qin De Fu is Huang's version of the Great Gatsby. We know that. Did you read the story, the novel, The Great Gatsby? Yeah, okay. James, tell me about The Great Gatsby.
It's been about 20 years since I read it, but it's about...
20 years?
Yeah, we read it when we were 13 years old, first year of high school.
15 years old?
13
years old, really?
Maybe even earlier than that.
So all four of you have read the story, The Great Gatsby, right? Okay, so tell me about your impressions on this short story, the novel.
I remember he's Irish Catholic, and he makes a lot of money, but even though he becomes very rich, mm-hmm. he can't really become an accepted person of the upper class because of this Irish Catholic lower class background.
But what does Gatsby do? What does Gatsby do? We know that he's very rich, right? Because there's many rumors about what he did, right? Because there's one rumor he's a jet lagger. He sells prohibited wines, right? And anyway, he might be a figure in the underground world, right? Okay. And what perspective was the story told from? The narrative.
I think his name was Nick.
Nick, right? Nick Carraway.
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay. Do you know that there's a new version of this story made into a movie? And it's going to play maybe this Christmas, and the main figure is played by Leonardo DiCaprio, and the narrator, the Nick Carraway, is played by Tobey Maguire. So I feel very strange, because I always see that how does this Spider-Man go into the movie, this Great Gatsby. Okay, so anyway, because both of these two stories, everybody needs Qin De Fu and the Great Gatsby is about underground figure. Okay, so we know that there's many similarities between these two stories. And we also know that both of these two stories are told from the protagonist's friend's perspective. So this is also something very similar. And we also know that in Great Gatsby, actually there's no one really need Jay Gatsby, right? We know that all of the figures in the story, they just need his money, and he's treating them to the parties, right? So I think this is very. They have many similarities between these two stories. Okay. And we know that Huang Fan is a pioneer of both urban fiction and postmodern fiction in Taiwan. In the 1980s, Huang Fan developed himself into a pioneer in both the spheres of urban fiction and the postmodern fiction. In the former category, his representative works are City Life, 都市生活, and Tycoon, 财阀. And in 1985, he published How to Measure the Width of a Ditch, 如何测量水沟的宽度, arguably the first postmodern work of fiction in Taiwan. Because in Taiwan, you can find many collections of postmodern stories. And usually, the collection will include this piece of work by Huang Fan. So Huang Fan's this story, how to measure the width of a ditch, is considered to be one of the most important postmodern work in Taiwan. And if you want to know about Huang Fan's relationship with postmodern fiction, you can check this book. It's newly published last year, maybe next October. It's Zero and Other Fictions, published by Columbia University Press. Okay. And we know that Huang Fan has a very serious literary obsession with the urban world. Okay. And we know that after Taiwan's defeat of spill international politics, the political tumults in the 1970s, an economic boom greater than ever rose to stimulate its urban development. This is the background of Huang Fan's writing. And Huang Fan is a native of the area around Longshan Temple. Do you know Longshan Temple?
Near
Wanhua. Yeah. Well, Dan, do you know this area?
I've heard of it.
It is a very traditional area in Taipei. So because it's very traditional, and it's in the west district of Taipei. So many of the residents in Wanhua and in the area around Longshan Temple, they witnessed the transformation of Taipei City. Because around this area, you can see the old, and many things are old and many things are new. And this is a very confusing and a very interesting experience for the residents in the area. So I think this is the reason why Huang Fan want to write so many stories about that area. Okay, so Huang Fan used to say, this passage is very interesting. This is from the Huang Fan, his own personal observation of the world, of the development of Taipei's urban world. The urban world in Taiwan was a mixture of New York, Tokyo and Calcutta, where new communities sprang up like forest, present a frightening sentence. And this thing can be seen in the story of History of Condo Sales. No one was obliged to be good tempered. So this is quite true for Zhang Dachun too, because in the fortune building, there's no one quite good tempered, right? English could be learned in 7 days. And English is something very international, right? So Taiwanese used to have a very bad command of English. And after 1980s, Taiwanese started to have better command of English. And so this is a sign of Taiwan's globalization and urbanization. And English could be learned in 7 days, and anyone could intimidate the taxman and be a success before 40. What is most ironic for Huang Fan is that even the monk in charge of Longshan Temple's hospitality can speak fluent English. So this is, did you find that, James, in your visit to Longshan Temple?
I think Longshan, the area, I think one of the reasons it's so famous is this is used to be a Hei
Shekhui
area.
Yes, right.
And even now you go there, it's very different.
Do you know a Taiwanese movie named Meng Jia? Yeah, it's based on the area around Longshan Temple. Yeah, but so I think if you are interested, you can see the movie. Okay, so you see it's about the underground world, right? And what other elements are there in this area?
Prostitutes,
yeah, right.
And snakes.
Mm-hmm.
So a lot of anything you want.
Yes. Okay. So it's very traditional, and it's very old, and it's very stereotypical, right? So I think Taipei City Hall had for many years tried to change this kind of stereotypes for both Taiwanese people and foreigners. So I think this is a very important social problem in Taipei. Okay, and for this story, the history of condo sales, it was published first in 1987, and in the supplement to United Daily News, we know that James has talked about Zhang Daozun is the chief writer of literary supplement to Chinese China Times, right? And we also see that there's another important literary supplement that is called United Daily News Literary Supplement. Okay, so and like Huang's How to Measure the Width of a Ditch, this story has always been described as both his Taiwan's first postmodern short stories. Do you know about the feature, main features of postmodern stories? James, Dan, do you understand what the qualities of the postmodern stories?
I know postmodern a little bit in general. It involves one of the themes is destroying the center, or showing that the center never really existed.
Yes.
It means that everything that's been built, all these superstructures, are really founded on nothing, or are really not as stable as they seem. A lot of times, stories will be told non-linearly or out of time order.
Mm-hmm.
That's common as well.
Okay. So I think from your understanding of the postmodern fiction, we know that all of the postmodern writers, they try to present the theme of maybe the themes of unreasonability or ridiculousness, right? And maybe they just want to try to write in the less traditional way, right? They want to distinguish themselves with the previous writers in the modernism and the realism, right? So they write in a very interesting ways. Okay, but according to my understanding, from my own perspective, postmodern stories or novels do not try to tell stories or to make sense. So this is something very important, because they are mainly about exploring the possibilities of a storytelling. This is from the perspective of postmodernity, that is maybe it's not about stories, but storytelling. It's what matters is a storytelling. That is how stories can be told and how a plot can be manipulated in order to make readers reflect upon the nature of fiction as a genre. So this is very important. So sometimes when you are reading this story, a condo history of condo sales, you will find that there are many irrelevant elements of this story. For example, there's an analogy brought out by the narrator Zhou Yaozhong to the end of the first section. I think this is not related to the story itself. Okay. And from the story structure, we can see that the first section is the name of the construction company. Do you think that this is related to the story itself? Because I think for me, this is just a diversion. This is a very ridiculous diversion from the story itself. And from the second section to the sixth section, we see the real story itself. And in the second section, we see Zhou Yaozhong and his complaints about the architectural industry. And in the third section, we see Zhou Yaozhong brought out his monumental project of architecture. And the fourth section is his project was underway. And the fifth section is Zhou Sports wanted to join the project. In sixth section, we see the project complete with an unexpected ending. What is the unexpected ending? James, do you remember the unexpected ending?
It's a comic element. Everything in the apartment is so small that the main character looks very large.
Yes. So do you think is very interesting or very ridiculous?
I think the whole story is very funny.
Okay, very good. Okay, and there's something about the opening section I have to talk about, because the story's open section is mainly about a relationship between the names and the company and their owner, and the many analogies brought out by the narrator protagonist Zhu Yaozhong. Toward the end of the first section, Zhu proposed a question: do all those discussions about names and analogies make sense? And Dan, as an answer, can you tell Zhu Yaozhong the answer to this question? Do they make sense?
Are you talking about where he draws something like?
Yeah, all those analogies between his boss and the company's names. Right. Do you think they make sense?
A little bit, but I think it's a bit of a stretch.
Mm-hmm.
I thought it was a bit of a stretch.
Mm-hmm. Okay, and I think actually they make no sense at all from the perspective of the story, because that's not the main point of the story, but to make sense from the story, from the perspective of storytelling. So that's what I'm talking about. The story writers, they try to make the story a little bit different from the previous styles of writing. Okay. And from the ending of the story, we know that the narrator say, Zhu Yaozhong say that everything about it is tiny. Tiny living room, tiny bedrooms, tiny chairs and tables. In fact, it's made in the perfect scale of a kindergartner. So, and do you think this is about his complex of inferiority? Yes.
Yeah, for sure. It's, you know, all these people, even the boss, has that ridiculous desire to have the pigs in his house.
Yes.
It's also some sort of complex.
Mm-hmm. Okay. So, do you think Zhu Yaozhong, he overcome this kind of complex?
No, I don't think any of the characters did.
Okay. Dan, do you think he overcome this kind of complex?
No, but I think it's better than wearing specially designed boots to make him look tall.
Okay, very good. And in this short story, we see there are three kind of main characters besides Zhu Yaozhong. The first one is the boss. What do you think of the boss? Yes.
I think he's an interesting character, but at the same time, a lot of the story has to do with the reality is completely different from the image.
Mm-hmm.
And the image of this boss of a very successful real estate development company would be that he's actually a very wise engineer or an architect.
Mm-hmm.
But actually, he's not.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Because he's only a businessman that try to make more and more money, right?
And even the name of the company,
mm-hmm.
people would think that such a prestigious company would have a very wise, would choose their name very carefully. Actually,
mm-hmm.
it was a mistake.
Yes, it's even a joke, right? Okay. And Rachel, what do you think of this boss, the boss of Zhu Yaozhong, the main character? Yes.
And
what did he ask for?
Yeah,
he wanted to have a pig pen in his house, right? Okay. So I think this is a way to because first in the first part of this short story, we think that this boss is a very serious man, right? But in the end of the story, we see how the writer make fun of this boss. Because we know that he want to go back his earlier life, he want to have a big pig pen, and he was not happy with his big house right now, right? So he want another style of house, okay? And we also see the wife of Zhu Yaozhong. He's a company worker in the same company with Zhu Yaozhong. And also there's an important group of characters that they are the participants of this project. Right? Okay. We see all these participants. We see the participants of the project. There are, for example, there are Zhang Hongzhong. He's a single. And this, what does this single mean? He says that he's really a single. it's not that only he's unmarried. He's that he didn't have any friends and family in the short story, right? So he wanted a living space that can separate himself from the world, right? And we also see a housewife named Li Jingling. He's also a participant of this project. And we also see a feng shui practitioner. And what does this feng shui practitioner function in this short story? Miriam, do you know about feng shui? You know what is feng shui?
Yeah.
Yeah. What is it about? Yeah. Okay. Very good. And what does this feng shui practitioner say about his he wants to be a part of this this project? Did he say anything about it? Yeah, he said it's a very great idea, because according to the idea, the whole idea of feng shui is about the arrangement of the space of the house, right? So if you are a part of this project, you can arrange your living space according to your own will and your own ideas, right? So this is very the reason that the practitioner want to be a part of the project. And we also see a fashion designer. And he also want to be a part of this project. Yeah. And we also see a man with two wives. This is very interesting, because this man want a house that can conclude two families at the same time. And the two spaces in the house are completely independent. But the two families can live in the house together. So he asked to participate in this project. And we also see a private detective. What does the private detective say about this project? James, do you remember?
He wants places he can live.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
To work for the government or something like that.
Mm-hmm. Okay. So I think this is also very funny, because the living space has something to do with your job. We also see another lottery winner. Okay, what is this lottery winner? What does this lottery winner say? Did he say anything? Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. So he just want to spend find a way to spend his money, right? Okay. So we have another. But this lottery winner is obviously luckier than the last lottery winner in Zhang Daojun's story, right? Okay, and we see the theme and the social background of this short story. After the long diversion, the diversion of the analogies between the analogy among the Nian. A name of the company and the owner and Zhu Yaozhong himself. Zhu went back to the main stuff of this story, the essence of the architecture and how it should be done in order to fit human nature and the needs of people. Because according to himself, according to maybe this is Huang Fan's own perspective, he thought that in the modern society, the city world is the living space of the city world is not too human, because it cannot satisfy the needs of a human being. So the name coined by Zhou's journalist friend is the most suitable for this thing, the buffet style building, because you can ask what you want in the project, you can fulfill your own needs in the project. Okay, and also, we can see this story as a social criticism of the problem of the rising prices of condos in Taipei City. This is a very important social issue recent years, because we know that many of the people in Taipei, they cannot afford their own house. So many of the government try to help them. And the story is written in the first heyday of Taiwan's condo sales. So it can reflect Huang Fan's thinking about this social problem. Condo prices started to rise higher than ever, and many businessmen and landowners also became wealthier than ever for selling buildings or lands. So I think this is very important, because more and more people sell their lands to the construction businessmen, and so that the construction businessmen, they can make money from the construction projects. So this become a very important problem in Taiwan. And also, when the city are full of when there's no longer any lands in the city that these construction business can use, they went to the countryside to find more lands to build their house, and it will affect the life of the countryside. So I think this is also a social problem. Okay. So in 1989, 2 years after the story had been published, a social movement named the Movement of the Shoeless Snails was initiated to draw nationwide attention. People who could not afford to buy their own houses or departments stood up to protest against the rising real estate prices, but the effect was limited. I think this is quite natural, because you cannot help it. I think maybe in your country you can see this kind of problem. Then is this a very urgent issue in St. Louis?
Not that I know of. Actually, it depends on what part of the city, but I think they're actually having a devaluation problem with people leaving the city.
Mm-hmm.
So I think they're trying to find ways to revitalize neighborhoods and raise property values.
Mm-hmm.
They want to raise property values, not lower them.
Okay.
So not right now, at least.
Okay. And Miran, is this very important social issue in the in Europe or in North Europe? The north part of Europe.
Well, I heard the countries are big, but because there's so few people that are into cities, and the cities are built full, there are people without houses, so the prices are really high.
Mm-hmm.
And does
the government do something about it, about the problem of the high prices? Okay, so I think it's quite common in many places of the world. Okay, so from the short story, we can see many urban problems. Many of the urban problems in those days can be found in the fourth section, the episode of the team building trip around the island for all the buffet style building participants. From their remarks, we can see all these problems. Okay, the first one of the urban problems is the freeway. So we know that freeways, the first freeway in Taiwan was built during the 1970s. So the freeway is, I think it's still a new experience for Taiwanese people in the 1980s, okay? So if you want to build new ways, you have to procure the lands. And you have to procure the lands from people. Government have to buy the lands from people. And it will affect the life of the people, right? So it's a very important urban issue. Freeways, from the perspective of one of the participants of the project, freeways are absolutely the murderers of traditional communities. The towns that freeways cut through have been completely bled of their unique cultures. So I think this is very important, because if the government chose your home as the chose your home as the route of the freeway, you have to move around, you have to move to another place, and you will miss the contact with your original neighbors. Maybe this is one of the problems. And you have to adapt to another living environment. So this is maybe those who have to relocate themselves. This is a great problem. And we also see another problem is the standing in the city. So many of the social theorists that came about this problem, because in modern society, the urban world has become more and more the same. It didn't have some kind of quality of diversity. So this is a problem for some of the theorists. So according to one of the participants, it was said that, isn't that right? Just to accommodate those freeways, everyone's been building the same cookie cutter houses, building higher fences, granite envelopes, everything. Darkness is everywhere. So this is one of the outcome of the construction of freeways, and this is the another social problem in the city world. And the third problem is that this is quite serious in Taiwan. If you are living in the Taipei city, right? And you can feel that Taipei city is a very very lack of urban planning. For example, sometimes you will find that there are some routes for the buses, there are bus only routes on the road, but the city hall build the routes first, and after some people criticize about it, the routes are not used anymore. This is a very common problem in the urban world of Taiwan. And the way people, this is for another question, the way Taiwanese people trample their own living environment is simply astonishing. Roads need repair all the time. Do we have this kind of impression about Taipei's roads? Dan, do you feel the same way with as the participant?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so James, do you find this problem in Taipei? We repair the roads all the time, so the road is not flat.
Yeah, in the area I live, they repair pretty frequently, mm-hmm. but I think it's unavoidable because of Taiwan's geological situation.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. What do you mean by geological situation?
Earthquakes and then rain.
Oh, okay, I see. Okay. So you mean that the earthquake or the flood will affect the roads, so it has to be repaired all the time?
I think so.
Mm-hmm. But it's for many cases, it's also about political corruption. Because sometimes you use all this money to repair the roads, but finally you found that the roads is not properly repaired. So it's about political corruption sometimes. And the bridge is built with no foresight. And the tunnels stuck everywhere. No street is built. Also, this is another social problem in Taipei. Okay. And the fourth problem is according to this participant, Taipei, the style of Taipei's buildings can be named as the world architecture chop suey. What is chop suey? Do you know what is chop suey?
It's a fake Chinese food that we eat in the U.S.
Yes. What is it made of?
A lot of things. Depends what restaurant you go to. Maybe like cabbage, noodles.
Mm-hmm. You don't know that? Then you don't know that?
I've always used the term chop suey, but I've never really eaten it. I don't know why.
Okay.
Does that have it? Chinese buffet?
Yeah.
Okay,
it's probably Americanized Chinese food, but it's, I don't think it's real Chinese food.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's Chinese food, but it's a Chinese food from the 19th century. It's not quite common in all places in China or Taiwan, but it's very popular in the southern part of Taiwan in the later 19th century. Rachel, do you know what is chop suey? You never had it. Okay, maybe you can try. You go to maybe many of the Chinese restaurants have this kind of dish. This is a very maybe this is some kind of very common food. But anyway, we know this chop suey means a combination of many elements, right? Because in chop suey you can eat noodles, vegetables, or maybe lungs of the livers of the intestines of animals, or for example, pigs of or other animals, right? So this is called chop suey. So according to this participant, it's worse in the big cities, of course, because buildings sprout like weed. We might as well call it the world architecture chop suey. Zero color or coordination, no fire escapes, no leisure spaces, all concrete jungle. So this is, of course, this is from, this is Huang Fan's own impression about Taipei City, and he used this four participants as his mouthpiece to present his ideas in the short story. So with all these participants, we can see the social problems from Huang Fan's perspective. Okay, so I think this is another very serious problem of Taipei City. Okay, so can you tell me some of your impressions about when you are reading this short story, Rachel? And do you think his writing is very humorous?
It is. Because I can't really imagine the building that was built because they said it was so horrible on the outside or mm-hmm. something like that. So
that was a... Okay, but I think we can imagine that the outside of the building might be some kind of monstrous, but because it's not the same every part of the building, right? So I think it's very interesting who can create this kind of architecture. And Dan, what's your impression about this short story?
I like the story. I didn't like the people that he found to live in the apartment or in the condo that he built. At one point, they seem more aware of what was going on, but they seem really annoying too. At one point, they were complaining about the Taiwanese highway system mm-hmm. while they were on a bus
yes.
on a Taiwanese highway,
mm-hmm.
which is really...
So very ironic,
yeah,
right?
Yeah, a little bit hypocritical.
Yes.
They kind of annoyed
me. Mm-hmm. Okay. And you're in. We know that in this short story we can see many social issues. What's the most important social issue for you in this short story? You mean what characters selfish? All of them, really? Okay. Well, why?
Well, they're so disappointed in the Western society because it doesn't give confines to their specific wishes or what they want to do.
Mm-hmm.
That's why they can be part of this.
Mm-hmm. What person do you think this protagonist, the Zhou Yaozhong, is?
Well, he tries really, really hard to compensate for his disappointment on his height.
Mm-hmm.
So that makes him ridiculous. I think it makes him also very human.
Mm-hmm. Okay, James.
Ridiculously expensive because of the costs. Mm-hmm. Make every room round, waste of the alternative to the current housing situation we have now? Because all these demands, all the people who are unhappy with it, their alternatives are so much worse.
Mm-hmm. Okay. So, but I think one other very important message that Huang Fei want to express in this short story is that after all, the social problem of housing is not resolved, even though he proposed this kind of very monumental project. Because you have to have money. If you want to have a house, a Buffett-style house, you have to have enough money, right? But this is not, this problem is not resolved by the end of the story, right? So I think this is also a very important message. So we can say that this this is also a very important message that Huang Fei want to tell us. Okay, and Amanda, what's your impression about this short story? And can you speak louder? Okay, and can you sympathize with all these social issues or social problems from your own personal from your own personal experience?
As in, if I ever,
I mean,
seen
yeah, have you ever noticed this kind of social problems in your own in your own experience? Okay, very good. Okay, so let's call it a day.